Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Our today's topic of discussion is complications of appendix. In our last lecture by Professor Dr. A.G. Rehan, you were taught about acute appendicitis and its management. And this topic for today is continuation of your topic of appendicitis. So what are the complications of appendicitis? I will tell you in detail about appendicular perforation, appendicular abscess, appendicular mass. These three complications are more commonly seen in a case of appendicitis when the patient comes late, sometimes a neglected case, or patient don't bother and presents late in hospital, then the chances of appendicular perforation, abscess formation and mass are there. And then other complications are neoplasm, mucosal of appendix, diverticula of appendix, interception of appendix, and portal pyema. So there are certain risk factors that predispose to complications of appendicitis, especially appendicular perforation. These are extremes of ages. If the patient is a small child or an elderly person, the patient is more prone to develop appendicular perforation. Then if the patient is immunocompromised or diabetic patient or patient is having fecalates causing appendicular obstruction, or the appendix position is pelvic. So these are the cases where the complications related to appendix are more commonly seen. So first and the most common complication of acute appendicitis is appendicular perforation. Here in this picture you can see there is a purplish spot at this area. You can see it's a very severely inflamed appendix, the appendicular edema and suppuration you can appreciate, and then there is a purple spot. So when the patient comes at this stage, patient will have more severe marked clinical signs of appendicitis, and clinically you are suspecting whether the appendicular perforation has occurred or it is about to perforate. So this picture is taken of a case of suspected appendicular perforation, and when it was opened, it was showing the appearance of appendix was that of near to perforate. It has not yet perforated. But in the next picture you can see here, when the patient presented with the symptoms and signs of severe appendicular appendicitis, and it was explored and it was found to be perforated. Here you can see it's already perforated. So how you clinically, here the question arises, how you clinically differentiate a case of acute appendicitis from appendicular perforation? I presume that most of you will be able to answer this question, because clinically sometimes in early cases of acute appendicitis it's difficult to diagnose it, because there are so many other differential diagnoses. There will be you may find tenderness in right iliac fossa, sometimes rebound tenderness only, but the symptoms and signs are not so marked. But what you see, what you find in a case of appendicular perforation, you will find patient will have a complaint of severe pain in right iliac fossa associated with vomiting. Patient will have complaint of fever as well. And when you will assess clinically, when you will do examination, you will find a rapid pulse. And patient may have maybe dyspneic, patient will have a shallow breathing as well. And if you examine the abdomen of the patient, I have told you what you will find on superficial palpation. In the case of appendicular perforation, you will find there is guarding in right iliac fossa. As you will take your hand towards right iliac fossa, patient will make her abdomen tight. That is, guarding will be positive. And when guarding is positive, then it's better not to go for a deep tenderness test or rebound tenderness test, because it is suggestive that if guarding is there, that means some severely inflamed or perforated appendix is lying underneath. So Rofsing sign will also be positive, and patient if a case of appendicular perforation is further delayed, you may say for another day or so, it will progress to generalized peritonitis. And then instead of guarding, what you will find? You will find a rigid abdomen. That is, appendicular perforation, if not timely operated, it will proceed to generalized peritonitis, and patient will have all the signs and symptoms of peritonitis in that case. So, as it's better to operate on a patient if the patient is diagnosed to have appendicitis, to operate early on, and if the patient comes at the stage of appendicular perforation, then immediately you resuscitate the patient, you give IV fluids, you give antibiotics, we give analgesics, and after baseline investigation and fitness for anesthesia, we immediately take the patient to theater so that you may find you may operate on a case when it is not yet perforated. So the patient is saved from the complications of late opening, late exploration, and patient you may protect the patient from septicemia. Okay, another complication of appendicitis is appendicular abscess. This results from localized perforation. If a case of appendicular perforation is not operated earlier, it may proceed to generalized peritonitis, or it may proceed to appendicular abscess formation. Abscess should be surgically or percutaneously drained. If it's a bigger abscess, then you will have to do surgical exploration and drain it. But if it is a smaller appendicular abscess, you may go through a minimally invasive approach by ultrasound guided percutaneous aspiration of abscess. Here you will be thinking that if we drain appendicular abscess, what we will do with appendix that is causing that abscess? So the answer is that in a case of appendicular abscess, it's very sometimes it's very difficult to find a severely inflamed appendix, but it's easy to drain the abscess associated with appendix. So usually what we do that we approach the appendicular abscess from retroperitoneal area, from the right, you make an incision in the right iliac fossa, then you while remaining outside the peritoneum, you approach the abscess, but you don't enter into the peritoneal cavity, because entering the peritoneal cavity in case of appendicular abscess means that you will spread this abscess to generalized peritoneal cavity. So it's better that remaining outside the peritoneum, you drain the appendicular abscess, and we must not be so much enthusiastic to try to find and locate the appendix, because doing so, that if you try to find the appendix in a case of appendicular abscess, you may damage the appendix and surrounding viscera. You may damage ileum, cecum, and the surrounding blood vessels and omentum and these things. So usually in a case of appendicular abscess, we only drain the abscess and we leave the appendix behind, and later on we can do interval appendicectomy after 6 weeks when all the adhesions have settled down. So next complication is appendicular mass. Why appendicular mass forms? Because when the symptoms of appendicitis start, patient usually don't bother these symptoms. Patient takes treatment from some local doctor or self-prescribed medicines, and usually this happens in case of males. Because females are very usually most of the cases, female patients are very sensitive to pain, so they present earlier, and it has been seen that appendicular mass formation is very uncommon in female patients because of early presentation to hospital. But in males, usually they don't bother, or they take some self-prescribed medications, and they delay and they don't come to hospital in time. So what happens that this inflamed appendix invites adhesion formation from surrounding omentum and surrounding loops of small gut. So all these surrounding intestine as well as omentum, this form adhesions with appendix and form an inflammatory mass. So this is appendicular mass, and inflammation is localized to the right iliac fossa by the omentum. Patient is usually pyrexial. Patient will have fever, and patient will have a palpable mass in right iliac fossa. So now, what you will do if you find when you assess the patient clinically, when you examine the abdomen of the patient and find a mass that is palpable in right iliac fossa, what will be your approach? So some students will answer that we will do operation, and some of you may answer that we should wait for some time. So the answer of both of you is right, but you will have to justify your answer. So those who are in favor of conservative management of appendicular mass, what's the logic behind? Because appendicular mass, as I have told you, means that there are dense adhesions between small gut loops and omentum and appendix, and if you open that and try to separate those adhesions, you may cause additional damage to the surrounding loops of intestine. This may lead to formation of enterocutaneous fistula or spread of the sepsis. So it's better to wait for some time in the hospital. We do a watchful waiting. I will tell you in next slide how we proceed when we choose the option of conservative management. But sometimes, even in the case of appendicular mass, patient is very septic. Patient has rapid pulse and fever and a very tender mass. So in those cases where patient is developing signs of sepsis, even in the case of appendicular mass, we have to do early exploration. So please don't confuse this. The treatment of appendicular mass, if the patient is not very tender, is not having signs of sepsis, the treatment of appendicular mass is conservative management. But if the patient is very toxic, tender, febrile, you will have to do early exploration of that mass. So when we opt for conservative management of appendicitis, that conservative approach is called Ochsner-Sharon regime. And this is a very favorite exam question. Examiner will ask you on bedside, what is Ochsner-Sharon regime, how you will proceed for that. So you will tell the examiner that this is Ochsner-Sharon regime is an approach for the conservative management of appendicitis. You ask the patient to remain nil peroral, nothing to take peroral, and we start intravenous fluid, and once the patient starts improving, we can allow the patient oral sips. We observe the patient, we monitor the vital signs, and we daily monitor if the symptoms of the patient are improving. And on the abdomen, we take a permanent marker, waterproof marker, and we mark the outline of the mass. And then every day we assess if this inflammatory mass is increasing in size or it is decreasing in size. Decreasing in the size of the mass means inflammation is settling, improving. And along with the reduction in the size of mass, if the vital signs are also improving, then there is no hurry to go for appendicectomy. We can wait the patient. But contrary to that, we have marked the mass and mass size is increasing. Patient is becoming febrile. He is becoming tachycardic and signs of sepsis start appearing. Then we have to stop Ochsner-Sharon regime and we go for surgical exploration immediately. And if the Ochsner-Sharon regime is successful, then we discharge the patient home with instructions that he should come 6 weeks later on for elective appendicectomy. Okay, next complication related to appendix is neoplasm of appendix. you might be remembering in my last lecture, I have told you about the carcinoid tumor of appendix in small gut neoplasm, and adenocarcinoma is another cancer related to appendix, although it is rare. Usually, we find it when we remove appendix, suspecting it is an appendicitis case. We remove appendix, we send it for histopathology, and histopathology comes out as adenocarcinoma of appendix. So, when this histopathology comes, doing merely an appendicectomy is not enough, because neoplasm has its invasiveness. It might have invaded in surrounding lymphatics, in small blood vessels. So we have to make patient free of this tumor by doing right hemicolectomy. So in case of adenocarcinoma of appendix, if the histopathology shows that this is adenocarcinoma, we will do a second surgery and we will do right hemicolectomy of the patient. This picture is showing a tumor of appendix that turned out to be adenocarcinoma. So, carcinoid tumor, also this is called agenophthalmoma, is a very common tumor out of all gastrointestinal tumors. Carcinoides, the common site of carcinoid tumor is appendix. So, this is in called agenophthalmoma because of the presence of agenophthalmin tissue, also known as Kulczewski cells in crypts of Lieberkern in appendix, and this is a neuroendocrine tumor of gastrointestinal tract because it is releasing some hormones, and its origin is from the neural crest tissue. So, it is called neuroendocrine tumor of the gastrointestinal tract. But its incidence in 1 out of 300 to 400 appendices, we find a case of carcinoid tumor. It is more common in distal third of appendix, and on grass section, it appears as a hard yellow mass in the appendix. It rarely metastasizes. These cancers have an ability to produce various peptides and hormones, for example, catecholamines and serotonin, that produce the symptom complex called carcinoid syndrome. Now, this last thing that I have told you just now, it's very important to understand. It's a very commonly asked question as well. You will be given a scenario that a 30-year-old male or female has a complaint of pain in right iliac fossa, and she has a complaint of frequent facial flushing, hypertension, frequent diarrhea, abdominal pain. What's your diagnosis? Now, if there is a clue that there is a right iliac fossa mass or swelling or lump, and these signs and symptoms of hormonal secretion, this give a clue that this is a case of carcinoid tumor that is producing these hormones that are giving rise to these symptoms and signs. It should be more clear in our next slide. You can see on cut section, it is appearing as a hard yellow mass. So, the common sites of carcinoid tumor out of all the intestine and viscera, appendix is the common site in 45% of cases of carcinoid. It is found in appendix, in 30% cases in small gut, in 20% cases in large gut, lung and bronchus in 10% of the cases, and other rare sites are biliary, ovary and stomach. And the tumor that is more than 2 cm in size is usually malignant tumor. Okay, what's the presentation of carcinoid tumor? I have already told you. Patient, because of the release of hormones and peptides, patient will have facial flushing attacks that are precipitated by exercise, emotions and alcohol. Patient will have an episodic watery diarrhea. Patient will have complained that every 2 or 3 days he has watery diarrhea. There will be hepatomegaly, bronchoconstriction. Patient will have shortness of breath. There will be telangiectasia of the face associated with this. There may be right-sided heart failure due to pulmonary stenosis and tricuspid regurgitation, that is sometimes a part of carcinoid syndrome. So how we diagnose? Because just merely on the symptoms, we can't make a definitive diagnosis of carcinoid syndrome. So to diagnose it, we ask for certain investigation like 24-hour urinary 5-hydroxy indoleacetic acid, or that is a product of catecholamines metabolism, or we can ask for 5-hydroxytryptophan or in the urine, or we can ask plasma serotonin level that will be raised in case of carcinoid syndrome. And then transabdominal ultrasound is the initial imaging procedure in most patients with metastatic carcinoid, but ultrasound will detect if the tumor is already metastasized to liver. It will detect multiple hepatic metastatic deposits. And then contrast enhanced three-phase CT scan or MRI followed by needle biopsy for pathology can be performed. And these all investigations we can perform if we are already suspecting that this might be a case of appendicular tumor, or there are features of carcinoid syndrome in the patient, then we will go for all these investigations before surgery. But sometimes it happens that the carcinoid tumor is not releasing so much hormones and peptides, and it is asymptomatic clinically, and it is found only once we do appendicectomy. Histopathology report comes and it shows that this is a case of carcinoid tumor. So what's the treatment of carcinoid tumor? We advise the patient surgical treatment. In case of appendicular carcinoid, treatment is appendicectomy or right hemicolectomy if tumor size is more than 2 cm. So is it clear that if the tumor is confined to the tip of appendix and its size is less than 2 cm, then that appendicectomy will be enough. But if its size is more than 2 cm or its location is near the base of appendix, then we will have to do right hemicolectomy to completely make patient get rid of this tumor. And then in case of symptomatic carcinoid tumor that is causing symptoms of hormone release, as I have already told you, we can advise patient somatostatin analogs, like patient is releasing serotonin, a somatostatin analog can decrease the release of serotonin and reduces the symptoms and signs of hormonal release. Then interferon A can be prescribed. And as it's a tumor, so systemic chemotherapy is also seen in certain research trials that there is some benefit from giving systemic chemotherapy to the patient. Okay, then another complication related to appendix is portal pyema. It's not so common, but sometimes this occur. What's this portal pyema? You know, the venous drainage of small gut and large gut, where the veins draining the gut, they ultimately go. Portal vein, okay, whether it is superior mesenteric vein, inferior mesenteric vein, splenic vein, hepatic vein, gastric vein, so this ultimately drain where? To portal vein. And if it's a case of severely inflamed appendix or appendicular abscess, so this inflammatory fluid will drain where? To portal vein, and from portal vein goes where? To liver. So there are chances that if it's a case of appendicular perforation, appendicular abscess or gangrenous appendix, the inflammatory mediators and inflammatory cells, this will go via portal vein to liver and leads to formation of liver abscess. So what's the treatment of portal pyema? We can give initially strong and good antibiotics. But if the abscesses are small and not resolving with the merely just giving antibiotics, then we opt for percutaneous aspiration of liver abscess. And lastly, some less common pathological conditions related to appendix are mucus. You can find mucosal of appendix. You can find diverticula of appendix. Although most common site for diverticula, as I think you might be knowing already, it's sigmoid colon. But sometimes, rarely, diverticula are seen associated with appendix. And then interception of appendix. I have already told you when appendix is involved in interception, what it will be called? That it's a lead point. So the appendix leading and interception will enter into distal part of gut, that is cecum, and causes interception, but it's not so common condition. So this was all about our today's lecture of complications related to appendix, a very, very commonly asked viva question, as well as your written short essays, MCQs, a very, very commonly asked question, a very important topic. So please ask if you have faced difficulty in understanding any of this complication. Okay, thank you.